How many know we serve an unstoppable God?
It's wonderful when we only have one song and you already feel the Lord's presence coming in. Thank you, Jesus. If this is your first time at Parkway, we welcome you. There's many ways that you can connect. If you're a first-time guest, please text WELCOME to our texting number, which is 414-253-8080. I practiced that yesterday just to make sure I wouldn't mess up. There's a couple other things you can text. If you'd like to give, you can text give to that same number. A prayer request, text prayer. You can see the list up here. I also wanted to take a minute and explain why I'm up here. I'm Sarah Polnow, and I am one of the Grow teachers, which is a class for members that have recently been baptized. So if you've recently been baptized, meet me at the back after the worship set, and we're going to have a wonderful class this morning. Okay, one more thing. On July 11th, we are having our Connect Fair for starting our Connect groups this summer. We want everyone to be involved. This is going to be a tremendous outreach tool. Groups of activities that we can invite our coworkers, neighbors, family, and friends to connect them with the body of Christ. All right, let's pray and we'll watch a short video. Lord Jesus, you're so good to us, God. We're humbled to even be here today, Lord. I pray, Jesus, that everything that is done here today will be following the leading of your Spirit, Lord. I pray, God, that our hearts would be open and softened to hear your word, and that we will leave changed, not the same. We love you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Keep Thank you.
by faith and not by sight, Jesus. We trust you. Hallelujah, Jesus. The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, won't be vain. Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Sing that with me. No, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory.
I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
This is how I fight my battle. This is how I fight my battle. This is how I fight my battle. Hands lifted high. This is how I fight my battle. We surrender to you, Jesus. This is how I fight my battle.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
Declare that all over this house this morning.
Overwhelm me.
What a powerful presence of God in the house this morning. I couldn't help but think while we were singing the song previous, of something found in the book of Acts, the fourth chapter. This isn't my message today, but I feel this is appropriate for us where we are currently. Acts chapter 4 and verse 8 reads this way. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost. Aren't you thankful for preachers who will stand and who will declare the word of God, not because of just necessarily what they've studied or what they know, but because of being filled with the Holy Ghost. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all. Now, this is just me, and this is how I read the scripture. Peter wasn't saying this in a humble manner. Peter was filled with the Holy Ghost boldness, and knowing that Peter had a little bit of issues with his flesh anyway, he wanted to make sure they all knew that he was talking to them. Be it made known unto y'all. You better listen to what I'm about to say. He says, and to all the people of Israel, that the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified. Now let's just establish something right away. He says, I want you to understand that this miracle that was wrought was done by the name of the individual that you decided to crucify. How ignorant do you feel now? That's just Peter. He says, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you. This is the stone which the builders set at naught, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now, I'm just going to tell you, this is the moment I had this morning. We were singing about, this is how I fight my battle. Listen, there comes a point in time in our lives where we have to recognize, I don't fight in my own strength, because if I do, I'll just continue to fail. But if I begin to fight from a position of revelation, if I begin to fight from a position of understanding that it's not my battle, but it's his battle, I began to think of an old song. There is power. Wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Where's my worship team? It's according to the blood that I've been redeemed. It's according to the blood that I have been translated from death into life. I have been moved from darkness into light. It is because of the power of the name of Jesus that I have been given all authority and all the privileges and all the benefits of this book. There is power in the name of Jesus. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is how I fight my battles. I gotta go back to a place that I'm reminded of what God did in my life. I gotta go back to a place that I'm reminded that there was a time that I was lost and dying, but the blood of the Lamb redeemed me. The blood of the Lamb restored me. The blood of the Lamb has positioned me. And now I'm destined to win. Now I've been given victory. Let's sing it one more time. There it is. Become aware of my desperate need for Him. And guess who we're going to talk about today? I just don't know how to talk any other way. How'd you like that string? My mom, the English proficient person, would have been cringing to hear that statement. But you know what? I'm just dumb enough and just simple enough to believe that if God would robe Himself in flesh, that He would go through all of the effort to redeem me. Why would He not continue that same effort to keep me, to restore me, to sanctify me, to position me, to bring me back to where He would have me to be? I'm thankful for a God who doesn't quit on His children. I have a couple announcements for you this morning. Number one, in the lobby today, you're going to find that there's a booth. And having been redeemed, now here comes the sales pitch. You better be ready. Having been redeemed, we've been commissioned to do the work of the kingdom, to do the work of the ministry. And as your pastor, my primary job is to preach the gospel and to prepare you to do the work of the ministry. Therefore, I have a ministry opportunity available to you. August 2nd through the 5th, I believe, if I have my dates correct, we're going to have a vacation Bible school here. And you will want your children to be a part of it. You'll want them to register for that. But I would also say that I know that they are looking for some volunteers to help. And so after the service this morning, don't be Jonah and don't go out the other way. Don't exit up here so you don't have to walk past the booth. Go out there and make yourself available if you can to be a part of VBS. Crystal will be out there at the table with her team. And they'll be looking to sign people up for that. The other thing that I want to say this morning before I get into the Word, and so you can begin to prep, we're going to Jonah, the second chapter today. I had the privilege yesterday and Friday to spend some time with some of our young men sitting alongside a river. We got rained on so hard, we camped We got rained on so hard. I have this awesome hammock that I string up between trees. You know, it's got this bug net. It's amazing. It's better than any tent you've ever slept in. Except for this time. Because it rained so hard, my hammock was soaked. And I had to sleep in the truck. That is not comfortable. That's worse than sleeping in a tent. But I had the privilege, and we talked about the things of God and challenged with one another's company. And in having conversation, I was sharing a little bit with one of them, a little bit of my testimony, and really how God has done some incredible things in my life. And it's a result of people who were faithful to the call of God that would do the work, make the investment, even when they probably looked at me and thought, "Dear God, you'll never amount to much." But nevertheless, faithful, my pastors, my parents, my in-laws, so thankful for them. And as I was talking about this church and the great leadership of this church, and I have the opportunity today to honor Brother and Sister Tamil and to be able to say, hold on just a second. I want you to applaud in a minute, but not yet. I was reminiscing, thinking about this young man who looked like he put his finger in a light socket and his hair was like, "Parent." And he wore suits that were way too big for himself and was really, really not all together. And Brother Tamil, you spoke some incredible things into my life. I remember going before the district board for my license. And I remember being frustrated with the call of God on my life, knowing that God wanted me to do something, not entirely sure what it was. And this man, before he was my pastor, before he was my bishop, really didn't even know me, took the time to sit down at a table and just invest into my life. Little did I know, and maybe at that time, little did he know, that we would be here today. And I don't ever want to forget that every generation has an opportunity to do something great, to serve their generation in a phenomenal way, but it only happens because they are building upon that which has been done by a previous generation, and they are standing upon the shoulders of another generation of great leaders. And so this morning, I just want to say thank you, and I honor you both this morning, and I think as a family, we ought to honor Brother and Sister Tamil this morning. I love you. I would also ask that you would continue to pray for Sister Tamil and her health and the challenges that she faces. We know that our God is more than able to heal and restore. But man, when we're going through it, what's taking so long, right? But God is faithful. And so continue to remember to pray for them and uphold her in prayer, that God would do that full work of restoration in her life. Okay, Jonah chapter 2. And I believe that today, again, I have a specific word for us, a challenging word for us, as we continue in this series. So verses 1 and 2 of this chapter reads this way: "Then Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish's belly and said, I cried by reason of mine affliction unto the Lord, and he heard me. Out of the belly of hell cried I, and thou heardest my voice." Would you pray with me before we go any further? Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you for your continued faithfulness to us. I thank you, O God, that no matter where we are, no matter our life situations, no matter our backgrounds, no matter our choices, one thing remains constant, and that is your love for us. And this morning, we thank you for your love. And we are reminded that it's because of your love that we win every time. Not sometimes. Even when our enemies would say, oh yeah, look, where's his God now? I know that even in those moments, I'm winning, for you have already won the victory. Help us, oh God, in these moments to continue to be faithful and consistent, to continue to walk according to that which we know, understanding that you are bringing us to a place of greater revelation and purpose. And today I pray that the word that is spoken, that it would prick our hearts, that it would call us to a place of recommitment and challenge, that we would be reminded again, just simply, of your great love for us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. As we continue our series this morning from Jonah, I want to remind you again of our friends, the vegetables. There they are.
We are the pirates, so don't do anything. We just stay at home and lie around. And if you ask us to do anything, we'll just tell you, we don't do anything.
I promise you, you will hear that every week until I'm done. Every week you will hear that. And you will know that song, at least that part of the song, very well by the time I'm done with this service. And there is a subtle message, well, maybe it's not so subtle, but there is a subtle message which I am trying to get across to you every time I play that, or I have them play that clip for us. And what we most certainly do not want is we do not want it said about us as they so seemingly proudly proclaimed, we don't do anything. And so last week we discussed the callous attitude of Jonah and how it seemed he had obviously drifted so far that he now found it within the normal routine of his life to disregard the voice of God. Can you imagine that? That your life slips to such a place that you can absolutely disregard the voice of God. Not only disregarding God's voice, see, there's a difference between not being able to hear his voice as there is to disregarding his voice. The Bible says, my sheep know, they know my voice. Which could also then say, the result of that is, if you're not hearing the voice of God, well, I'll let you fill the blank in. So we get to the place that not only is Jonah disregarding the voice of God, but also disobeying God's command. He hears what God says, and he says, not doing it. Not simply ignoring the voice of God, but openly rebelling and going in a completely different direction than God had mandated, determining within himself that he would not, as our vegetable friends, do anything. He wouldn't do anything that God had told him to do, especially this current command from God. And so today I want to talk a little bit about Jonah for just a moment and the city which he was called to. And so he's called to the city of Nineveh. Nineveh during this time was an impressive city. It was a city that had a population of some 120,000 people. And this was no small city, for historians say it would take 3 days to walk from one end to the other, approximately 60 miles. And consider, if you will, today all of the people from South Milwaukee, through Oak Creek, through Caledonia, and all the way through Racine. And that would just give you a rough approximation of how many people were in the city of Nineveh. It was a magnificent city, as historians tell us, but it was obviously very wicked. Some even compare it to Sodom. But it was a city that God wanted to save. Aren't you thankful today that in spite of all the things that could be said about us, all of the charges that could be brought against us, all of the list of things that would make us undesirable, yet the same statement that could be made about Nineveh is made about us. But God wanted to save that city. And so he's called a prophet, Jonah, to deliver a message that destruction was coming if the inhabitants of Nineveh did not repent. As a reminder, I would just help you today that Jonah not only disobeys the command of God, but he utterly disregards it and makes his way in the opposite direction of where God had told him to go. Headed to the city of Joppa, aboard a ship with God in hot pursuit. God is pursuing Jonah and causes there to be this great storm that arises on the sea. This great storm causes the truth to be revealed about Jonah's disobedience and then the subsequent throwing of Jonah overboard into the sea by the sailors who were navigating that ship. We left off last week with Jonah having been swallowed by the great fish that God had prepared. And by the way, did anybody just see this week? Somebody mentioned it to me and I got it today, that some other knucklehead must have not been doing God's will and ended up inside the whale's mouth. That dude's in the hospital. He must still not be listening to what God had for him to do. I don't know. So we left off last week with Jonah being swallowed by this great fish that God had prepared. And this week we pick up the account with Jonah now within the belly of the fish and him praying, really crying out to God. Isn't it interesting and frankly a bit unfortunate that often it takes great tribulation or tragedy for us to get to the place that we will finally realize, maybe I should call out to God. I mean, are we really? Okay, I gotta reel that back. Am I really that dumb? I don't wanna put that on you. But is it really that difficult for me to realize that God's trying to do something in my life, but it requires some great tragedy or tribulation for me to maybe say, hey, where's God at? I made this statement last week. It was easier, it would seem, well, not that it would seem, it was easier for God to bring Nineveh to a place of repentance than it was to get his own servant to do what he had ordered. I pray, God, let that not be the case with me. Let me hear your voice. Let me learn from Jonah's life and find myself more submitted to the will of God than ever before in my life. That it would be easy for God to move us in the right direction, that he would not have to bring harsh trial or harsh discipline to us in order to cause us to then obey his will, that we would not become so callous as to be indifferent about the lost of our community, choosing rather to protect our own pride than speaking the word of God to our world, fearing their rejection. More interested in protecting my pride that they might not want to hear what I have to say rather than doing the very thing that God has commanded me to do. This morning I want to specifically deal with the where, why, and when of Jonah's prayer. Our text, our opening text, verses 1 and 2, tells us that Jonah prayed unto God out of the fish's belly. This is obviously not somewhere any of us would choose as a prayer room. And can I just say this morning? I don't know where you're at with the mask and social distancing. I'm thankful for everybody that's respecting the wings and you only wear a mask and you socially distance in the wings. But for the rest of us that feel somewhat confident and comfortable and, well, frankly, we're kind of starting to wad up together again, which, glory to God, I'm thankful for. But I have been walking into our prayer rooms every Sunday morning, and I find them eerily empty. I would rather find my way to a prayer room than to find myself in a fish's belly as an alternative prayer room. I would rather find myself in my place of prayer of my choosing and location in my home or on my job or wherever it might be, rather than finding myself brought to my knees as a result of some tribulation that God has brought into my life. And so it, again, was not Jonah's choice of prayer room to be in the belly of the fish, but it was a result of his wrong choice that this now is his prayer room. It was where he was, and he chose to pray there. And the Bible tells us in verse 2 that when he prayed, that God heard his prayer. Two very important lessons for us contained within these two simple scriptures. It would be much better to pray in a normal place than wait until life has put you in a terrible place. Let me break it down a little more simply. It would be a whole lot better for me to decide every day that I'm going to intentionally spend time talking to God and building my relationship with God, that I might hear the voice of God, that I might honor God with my life, than not talking to him, not having a place to pray, until the sky falls down around me and I'm forced to pray in the midst of my dilemma. Don't wait until God has to allow some trial to come into your life to pray, some great hardship and tragedy. The second thing that I think we can gain from these first two scriptures is God can and God will hear us anywhere that we pray, no matter where we are, no matter the circumstances surrounding our arrival in the current storm of our life, no matter the wrong or sinful choices. If we cry out to God with a repentant heart, God will hear us. Let me just repeat that again. If we cry out to God with a recognition that I'm a sinner in need of a Savior, no matter where I am, God will hear that prayer. Let me say it this way. If we will realize that as a child of God, we have disobeyed our Heavenly Father, no matter what the circumstance, if I will call out to Him with a repentant heart, God will hear me. I'm thankful for that today. So today is the day for you and I to cry out to God and make sure that our hearts, our desires, our plans are in proper alignment with Him and His will. Don't wait for the storm. Don't wait. Make sure you know Him before you find yourself in the tribulation. The Bible further records in verse 2 that Jonah prayed as a result of his affliction. He hadn't obviously been as submitted to God as at other times in his life, and he is now fleeing from the presence of God, which, by the way, isn't that just a dumb idea? I mean, if you know anything about God, you know that if I ascend into the heavens or I make my bed in hell, he's there. He's omnipresent. There's nowhere you can go. That ought to make some of us really nervous this morning. He was there, yep. I might not be able to discern it right now. Your neighbor might not be able to discern it right now, but God knows, because he was there. Enough of that. So he wasn't obviously as submitted to God as he was at one time, and now he's attempting to flee God. And he was obviously not praying as he should have been. He is ignoring, discounting the chastening of God, this great storm that has now arisen as chastisement in his life. He's sleeping. He is sleeping in the bottom of the vessel. God is pursuing him, trying to get his attention. The storm clouds are looming. They're black. The waves of his life are now pounding against his vessel, trying to get him to come to a place of recognition that he would repent and make a course correction in his life. but he is so callous and disobedient and frankly rebellious that he takes a nap and he ain't bothered that God is about to drop a hammer on his life. I remember one time, this goes along with this moment of Jonah sleeping. Remember one time disciplining one of my sons, and I already told you this last week, so I spanked him. That's what I did. I spanked him. He was naughty and strong-willed and just wouldn't listen. I remember I got done correcting him, and like Jonah, he turned around and looked at me and he said, "That didn't hurt." Yeah, you know, you're feeling it too. That's what Jonah was doing to God in the middle of that storm. "This ain't nothing. Watch me sleep." So God says, "Okay, you're going to have that level of arrogance? Discipline's going to another level." And as a result of this arrogance, no longer just a storm, but now Jonah finds himself in the belly of this great fish, or as he would describe it, in the belly of hell. You'll have to talk to both of my sons and find out if they felt like they were in the belly of hell after whoever it was that made that statement. But he said, "I've been cast into the deep. The floods compass me about. He's talking about God. "Thy billows and waves passed over me." He said, "I'm as low as I can be at the very roots of the mountains. The earth with her bars have closed about me." And then he, just to add this last little bit of color, he says, "I got weeds wrapped around my head." I'm in a bad way. Life had to get real bad for Jonah to have a reason to pray. The storm didn't cause him to pray. Disobeying the voice of God didn't cause him to pray. Getting thrown overboard out of the ship didn't cause him to pray. It wasn't until he finds himself in the very lowest part of his tribulation that he thinks, maybe I ought to pray. The Bible says in verse 7 that when Jonah's soul fainted, he remembered the Lord. When Jonah gets to the very end of himself, he decides to be done running from the will of God. I would just pause and interject this right here. How many of you, don't raise your hand, how many of you are getting tired of running from the will of God in your life? I'm going to tell you, they used to have they still do. When I was in the military, sniper school, they had a little statement. They said, "You can run, but you only die tired." How long are you going to run from the will of God? It won't end well if you continue to run. You see, God loves us enough that he continues to pursue us. Are you getting tired of running from his will? So Jonah finds himself at the very end of himself, and he decides that the time for ignoring the voice of God is, it frankly is over. And his spiritual selective hearing, his deafness to the voice of God, all of a sudden, there seems to be a miracle of healing that's restored in his life. And he believes that he wants to hear now. And he believes that he can hear now. He has this moment where he comes to himself, if you will. Much like the prodigal son, he has a change of heart. And so in verses 7 through 9, the Bible says that Jonah remembers the Father, the blessings. What he remembers is he remembers the blessings of submission. He says that he is now ready to make the sacrifices of thanksgiving unto God, that he will that he will pay that which he vowed to God, those promises and commitments that he had made now forgotten. He is now recommitting to fulfill. And there is again a recognition within this context of prayer that Jonah says that salvation is of the Lord. I want to remind us this morning that no matter who we are, no matter what we think we've accomplished, no matter where we think we have arrived to, we all still need God. There is never a point in our journey that we become so righteous, so well off, so healthy, that we don't need God anymore. You see, it is God who holds my very life in the palm of his hand. And if it was not for the hand of God in my life, there would be no life. I want to remember that at no point will I ever be without a need for God. Because as I said earlier, there is salvation in no other than the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, ladies and gentlemen, you and I must never forget our need for God. We must be reminded always that it is the grace of God that even affords us the opportunity to have relationship with him. It's because of the grace of God, according to Paul's writings in Ephesians, that it's by this grace that we find ourselves now saved. You and I do not have it within our own power to be able to save ourselves. We need God. Every step of the way, we need God. And if you and I are going to make it, we have to realize this need in our lives. I would say also that the beautiful thing about this realization is that when we come to a place of needing him, when we come to this place that we recognize that we can't really do it by ourselves, when we come to this place of realization that without him we won't make it, and when we come to this place of desperately desiring relationship with him, I'm reminded of Revelation chapter 3 and verse 20. Where the Lord says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man would hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me." See, God is desiring for us to come to him, to find fulfillment for our lives within his will. I'm tired, and I've become tired of going my own way. I've become wore out pursuing my hopes and my dreams. But I find peace and contentment and rest when I pursue the will of God for my life. I find fulfillment when I find myself walking within his will. God is desiring for us to come to him. So the last verse of Jonah chapter 2 tells us that after Jonah's moment of repentance, after Jonah's moment of recommittal, that the Lord then speaks to the great fish, and something amazing happens. The fish pukes him up on the shore. What a Six Flag ride that had to have been. Wave your hands in the air like you just don't care. Booah, out on the shore. So Jonah finds himself vomited out of the fish on the shore. And it seems disgusting, but here again is the grace of God at work. God brings him right back to the place, to where he had called him to. Isn't it amazing? You know, we oftentimes make it really difficult for people when they walk away from God, when they find themselves away from God, when we find them in a place of a backslidden condition, we make it really difficult for them. And I want to say this morning, I'm not trying to say that just because an individual has walked away from God and they've lived in disobedience and rebellion against the will of God, that the moment that they come back, that we ought to just, everything goes right back. I mean, like you never left. I think that there's a part of human nature that says, you know what, I'm going to see if it sticks this time. But in the meantime, you are just as much entitled to what God is doing and what God has to offer as I am. And I think that because of this, it reminds me oftentimes with Jonah here, God doesn't take him all the way back and make him now go from Tarshish to Nineveh. God grabs him somewhere in his journey from there to Joppa, and he says, when you decide to repent, I'm going to position you or puke you right back out into your place of purpose. Now, can I just remind you that I'm sure Jonah didn't smell real good. The effects of his disobedience and rebellion were very noticeable upon his life. I've made this statement to you. You don't get to sow your wild oats and do what you want and then ask God for crop failure. You will reap what you sow. And just because you come back and make it right with God, don't expect life to just go back to the way it was before you walked away from God. You are going to give an account for that foolishness in your life. It's just the principles of God's word. But nevertheless, I look at Jonah and I'm reminded of the prodigal son. And I love the story of the prodigal, and especially this portion in Luke chapter 15 between like verses 17 and 19, where the son has left. And can I take you all the way back to the beginning when I said that Jonah didn't choose the belly of the great fish to be his prayer room, but it was a result of his choices that the belly of the great fish was his prayer room. The prodigal son made some very foolish choices and thumbed his nose at his father and said, give me what's mine and see you later. But the Bible says that the prodigal son comes to himself at the lowest point of his existence, where the scripture says he is so hungry that he would have ate the filth that was being fed to the hogs. And he says, hang on a second. I know what I'll do. I'll go back and I'll repent. And I won't go back with an expectation that the Father owes me anything. Quite frankly, I'll go back and just ask him to forgive me and make me as a servant. I don't even need to be considered a son. Ladies and gentlemen, this is where you and I could learn a lot. This is why repentance today in our vernacular has taken on really a much watered down reality of what it is. Because we have become chronic repenters oftentimes. God, I'm sorry, I messed up again, forgive me. And we do it so much for the same thing so often that it doesn't even move us. That we expect that we can just waltz in and out of God's presence no matter the filth and the foolishness of our lives, and he has to restore us, and he has to let us be his child, and he has to continue to let us be anointed, and he has to continue to give us authority. The Bible makes it very clear that we should not frustrate the grace of God. And just because grace abounds, it doesn't mean that we should abound in sin, but that we should walk after the Spirit, not pleasing the lusts or the desires of the flesh. So Jonah has this place. The prodigal son has this place. And the son says, I don't even deserve to be your son, but the Father. Oh, I'm thankful for my Heavenly Father. Because when I come to him with a true repentant heart, and I say, God, I have failed. When I come broken and say, God, I know I don't deserve your grace. I know I don't deserve your love. I know I don't deserve another chance. But would you forgive me one more time. I'm thankful again to be reminded, as I said last week, that He is faithful and just to forgive when we confess our sins, and He will restore. I'm thankful that if I go to the book of Joel chapter 2, that the promise is not just of the outpouring of His Spirit, but the promise is that which the enemy has come in, the grasshopper and the canker worm has destroyed. God says, I'll restore it, and I'll make something beautiful out of what appeared to be a tragedy. And oh, by the way, there is no depth too far that we fall that He is not able to reach us. There is no depth too far that He's not willing to pursue us. But it's in that moment of recognition in our lives, if we would simply come back to God and ask for His forgiveness, ask for His restoration, that we will find. Oh, not only will we have the opportunity to be a servant, but He will again cover. He will again restore authority in our lives. But please, let's not take it for granted that His grace simply says, you do what you want to do. Pray me this little patty cake prayer, and then you can walk in dominion right after that. We need to walk in a way that we are submitted to God's will. So Jonah has found himself now ready to do the will of God. And as the prodigal, the father restores Jonah. And he finds himself restored to his place of calling and purpose by the grace of God. You and I, again, have this opportunity to come to an altar today and be made new again. We have an opportunity again today, and I know that last week I dealt with this, and I'm okay with dealing with it again because I believe it's what God would have us to do. But I want to make sure that we as a local assembly, as individual believers, as the ambassadors of Christ, as children of God, make sure that we are in right standing and right relationship with our Heavenly Father. So today, again, I know that we have this opportunity to come to an altar and to again recommit our lives and again take inventory of our lives and where we are. And I can't help but think, I know that as I look across this congregation, there's a number of you who are dealing with trials and troubles. There's a number of you that have physical ailments. You are struggling with things emotionally and mentally. There are some of you, under the sound of my voice, dealing with addictions. There are some of you, under the sound of my voice, that you recognize yourself as that individual that has continually come back to God time and time again for the same thing. And sometimes we get to the place that we find ourselves going through the motions, just hoping that the motions will be enough. But it doesn't have to be that way. You see, because we can find victory today. It's amazing how God deals with me, and then my first message becomes a part of the message. But this is how we fight in every one of those battles. It's a realization that God paid such a tremendous price for our lives that He would not be willing to cast us aside on the heap pile of life, of brokenness and waste. But if we would desire to be restored, if we would be willing to submit to the care of the Father, He could set us aright. He could fix us. And once again, we could be restored to a place of purpose. And so within the troubles, within the storms of our lives, will we allow those to bring us the clarity that we need to return to God? I would have you stand to your feet this morning, and I would ask the worship team to begin making their way here. But there is a reality in our lives, and we talked about last week this countdown that is in motion. This countdown that really is the end of days. This countdown to the return of the Lord. This countdown to the judgment seat of Christ. This countdown to your last day on this earth. This countdown to an accounting of your life and your choices. And today, I'm wondering if you and I could truly just have a moment of introspection, and we would look into our lives and say, there are some things within me that I know probably are not altogether pleasing to God. And as a result, I want to make those things right. I would say that looking within our lives, we may even find ourselves in a place that we know that there are certain things that could be even maybe better submitted to God. We struggle with those things. But nevertheless, in our struggle, there's the blessing and the abundance of God. But we don't want to mistake the abundance and the blessing of God for God's approval upon our lives. We want to make sure that our lives line up with His Word. And so as a result of that, I say that you and I are here today. And really, there should be great hope that is found within our lives, because knowing who we are, knowing the poor choices that we oftentimes seem to make, knowing our inability to always submit to God as we should, the hope is that in the midst of our weakness, He still desires to strengthen us, to help us. In the midst of our failings, He desires to restore us. In the moments of our brokenness, He desires to put us back together as a testimony of His glory and His faithfulness. So this morning, standing here today, whether you find yourself in a storm of life that it feels like maybe the chastening of God has got you in the belly of hell, and it feels like that's where you're living, that's where you're walking, would you recognize that it's not God just being cruel and mean, but really the discipline of God is again a sign of His love for us. It's a means by which He can get our attention. It's a means by which He can bring us to a place of restoration. It's a reminder of how much He truly loves us. And so the altar is set before us today as a place to sacrifice, a place of sacrificing our will, saying, God, not my will, but Yours in my life. That I would come to an altar and I would say, God, I want to give You my all. I want to give You my everything. I want to honor You. And today, at the altar in my life, I again submit to You. Will you leave today reminded that no matter what it is that you are facing, no matter what it is you're struggling with, no matter how dark the secret, no matter how tragic the pain, no matter the shame, no matter how long it's been, His love remains constant. And you are here today not because you had other plans, but you're here today because God drew and drew and made an appointment for you today to make a choice. Your why, your where, your when. But will you pray? Will you call out to him today? Will you be restored in his love? Will you leave this place not wondering, does God love me? Could God use me? Does he care about me? The answer to all those questions is yes, he does love you. Yes, he does care. Yes, he will forgive. Yes, he will use you if you will respond. Let me pray. Praise your name, praise your name, praise your name. Hallelujah, Jesus. Why don't we just find a place to pray today? Why don't we make an altar in this place? God, we come to you today as broken individuals, aware of our frailty, knowing our insecurities, knowing, oh God, that we don't deserve, knowing that we've said no, knowing that oftentimes we've disobeyed. But I'm thankful that your love is not limited by my failures. I'm thankful today that your love is not overextended because of my choices. And I'm thankful today when I turn to you, that I know that I can be restored to my place of purpose and potential, that I can be covered, and that I can be in a place of authority. I pray today, Lord, for each person, that we would take advantage of this moment in time that you are giving to us, that we would not take it for granted, that we would not rush past this moment, but that we in this moment would again commit ourselves to you, that we would ask that you would forgive us for doing things our own way, that you would forgive us for going through the motions. I pray, God, that you would stir your fire within us again, that we might begin to burn with fresh passion and zeal. I pray for those that are here that need to be baptized the Bible way, in the name of Jesus, that today that they might have their hearts open and that they might make that step. Lord, that our hearts would be open to receive all that you have for us, that we not be willing to go another day living in our mediocrity and our apathy, but that we would pursue you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and that today we might leave this place with your abundant blessings upon our lives, knowing that I am a child of God and that it is well with my soul, for I have met my God at the altar. I thank you, God, for this moment. We praise you and we magnify you today.